saints of God, what a privilege it is to be in the presence of God, in the house of God. This is the very name of this house, Bethel. This is where we're supposed to be, where we ought to be. I was glad when they said it to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Now, those of you who came this morning looking and expecting a miracle, a healing, a deliverance, if you make your way, those of you brave enough, who are bold enough, and you need what you want for yourself, your child, your family, or just even, Lord, for your circumstance. And those in the balcony, just lift your hand by act of faith. So by act of faith, hallelujah. Father God, we stand by act of faith in your presence. By act of faith, we come here knowing that you are our God. Lord, we're seeking your Shekinah glory, that glory that makes itself known and manifests itself, but with nothing else, we can confuse it with nothing else. You are Jehovah God. You are our Rapha. Yes, you are healer, but you are Lord of the one who provides. You provided us this morning. You provide us with shelter. You provide us with transportation to get here to where we can now praise and seek your face and come boldly before the throne of God. So, Father, we stand in your presence and we thank you for the privilege of being now in a prayerful posture mode. So, Lord, we ask you right now for everyone that's standing, for everyone whose hand is lifted, for everyone who's present now, who needs a healing, Lord, of mind, of body, and spirit, who needs a healing, Lord, and maybe it's not for themselves, but for a family member, a child who needs deliverance, Lord, in their family, because, Lord, you're still healing, you're still delivering, you're still the God of miracles. Yes, Lord, why? Miracles may be mentioned in our words, but miracle is also in our presence. So now truly, Lord, I am a miracle. Just the mere fact, Lord, you allowed us to be in this presence, to be in this place, says that we are a miracle. So Father, now be that God today again, we pray, that God who heals, that God who delivers, that God who creates miracles. You are the one, Lord, and so we receive it by faith. We come now by faith. We seek now by faith your face early and often by faith. There's no other way we can please you except by faith. So, Lord, by faith, we are now here in your presence, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this honor. Thank you, Lord, for this privilege and for the man of God who has cast a vision for this moment, for the woman of God who aids and assists him in this moment, Father. So, Father, we are now truly in your presence, waiting for that miracle. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Almighty God, you are awesome in this place. We thank you this morning for another day. We welcome you, Holy Spirit of God. Do the work that you have prepared for us today. Fill the hearts and the minds of your people. Let them know, oh God, that you are with them. Father God, we thank you that we are never alone. We thank you, Father God, that we have someone that we can bring our hurts, our pains, and our sorrows, our sicknesses and diseases. We have someone through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, that will lead and guide us into all truth. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for teaching us the ways of God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being the great counselor of the people. Thank you, Father God, for the one who comes and empowers us with authority. We stand on the promises of God, and we thank you, God, that we are better today than we were yesterday. Father, we're learning to speak the word over ourselves and over our situations. We bind the hand of the enemy and the power and authority that you have given us. No weapon formed against us shall be able to prosper. The manifestation of your glory is in this house, God. The man of God will speak with authority and power, and it will change the hearts and the minds of all that hear, oh God. Father God, you are great and mighty in our sight. Father God, we need you like never before. Father God, continue the work that you have in us. You said you will complete that, oh God, in us. We are children of faith, God, and I thank you. We are those that believe in the power of God, in the healing manifestation. Oh God, the great comforter over our sorrows. Oh God, we thank you this morning, oh God, for you are mighty and strong, God. Move in this place today. Let your glory sit upon us like never before, God. Let the word, God, just pierce the hearts and the minds of your people. Show us your glory, God. Work in the man of God as he delivers the word of God. Cover his family, God. The angels of the Lord camp around each and every household. His mom is healed in the name of Jesus. His father is healed in the name of Jesus. His mother-in-law is healed in the name of Jesus. The whole house, Father God, is filled with your glory. And it extends to our homes, oh God. It extends to where we are. You are there with us. Lead us and guide us, God. Let us eat the meat of your word like never before, Father God. In the mighty name of Jesus, I give you the glory.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, bless your name this morning, Father. We come before you with thanksgiving in our hearts, God, and praise on our lips, declaring that you are God and beside you there is no other. We declare that you are sovereign, God, that your will and your way is perfect, Father. We come before you, Father, seeking, God, your healing power, seeking healing mercy and healing grace, God. We come before your throne this morning because we believe and declare your word that says whatever we ask in your name, that will you do, so that the Father is glorified in the Son. So we ask that you heal and deliver, to set free, God, to work miracles, signs, and wonders in our lives, God. Let us seek you with all of our hearts, God, and lean not upon our own understanding, God, but in all our ways acknowledge you and allow you to direct our path. Let our faith fail us not, God, no matter what we see, no matter what we hear, or no matter how we feel. Let us trust in you with all of our hearts, God. We lean and depend on you because you are our strength. You are our rock. You are our refuge. Oh God, you have become our hiding place. When the trouble of this world comes against us, God, we know that we can hide in you. We know that your mercy endures forever. So we pray for your divine healing, your divine deliverance, your divine miracles and wonders. And as we lift up the under shepherd of this house, we ask you to continue to bless him. Continue to bless his helpmeet, his wife, Pastor Kimberly McKissick. Bless their children, Lord. Bless their parents, Father. We declare that their latter days shall be greater than their former. We ask you to bless their entire family. And bless this house called Bethel, God. We thank you in advance. We give your name the glory. It's in the name of our Lord
hallelujah.
And Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God. Amen. Hasn't he been good to you this week? Amen. Has he been good to you this week, Lord God? Oh, Lord God, we thank you for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for your love, Lord God. We thank you how you've kept us and continue to keep us in the name of Jesus. We thank you for bringing us back once again, especially on this special day, this Palm Sunday, Lord God. And for that, we say thank you in the name of Jesus. Your word declares that healing is the children's bread, Lord God. And we claim that healing today, right now, in the name of Jesus. Healing from cancer, healing from diabetes, healing from high blood pressure, healing for resentment and anger, Lord God. Healing right now in the name of Jesus. It is ours according to your word, Lord God, and we claim it in the name of Jesus. Your word declares that whatever we asked in prayer, believing, we shall receive it. So we are claiming signs today, Lord God. We are claiming miracles, Lord God. We are claiming wonders, Lord God. Come into this sanctuary, Lord God. Open up the hearts and the minds of everybody that is under the sound of our voice, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Do what only you can do, Lord God. Do it right now, Lord God. Do it right now, Lord God. We are claiming it in the name of Jesus. You are so worthy in the name of Jesus. We give you all the praise, Lord God. We give you all the honor, Lord God. We give you all the glory because we know you deserve it. If you agree, come on now. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen.
Come on and keep those hands clapping. Lift your voices in the temple. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. For this day is the day that the Lord hath made. We shall rejoice and be glad. Are you glad to be here this morning, Bethel? Come on, come on. Don't stop. Give God a praise. It's Palm Sunday. This is the day where we celebrate Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. His power and his kingdom coming here. Come on. No. We're not going to let it die down. The Bible characters, they threw their branches on the ground. They threw their cloaks on the ground so Jesus could walk and come through on the donkey. That means we ought to praise him. Do you love him? No, I can't hear you. Do you love him? Come on and clap your hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me hear the balcony. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm reminded of a song, an old song that's so appropriate right here. I really love the Lord. Whose testimony is that today? Wave your hand. Come on, sing with me. Oh, I really love. Hallelujah.
I love the Lord. I love the Lord. I love the Lord. I love the Lord.
many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Isn't it a good thing to be able to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth? Do me a favor, turn to two or three people and just tell them, I'm glad to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. Tell them it's just good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Come on, greet them with the joy of the Lord. Greet them with the love of the Lord. Now do me a favor, can you just give God a praise for the neighbor you just spoke to? Come on, give God a praise for the neighbor you just spoke to. Come on, thank God that they are alive. Thank God that they are here. Thank God that they are in their right mind. Come on, every now and then you ought to just thank God for other people, for the blessing of life that God has given to other people. Come on, open up your mouth and give God a praise all over this sanctuary. God is worthy. I said he's worthy to be praised. Has the Lord done anything for somebody this week since last Sunday that you want to give him a public praise for? Hallelujah. Oh, bless his name. Take your seats in the presence of the Lord. It's just good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? We love the Lord. And we thank God for the privilege of worship. It's spring break, the end of spring break. Some of y'all broke. Yeah, folk with children, they done broke. In Jesus' name. So we welcome everybody who might have broke, but you're watching by way of stream. Come on, let's shout out everybody that might be watching virtually this morning. It is also the beginning of Holy Week, the week where our Savior set his face towards the cross of Calvary to die for the sins of the world. I just want to do a survey and ask, is there anybody in here glad he died for the sins of the world? That's the wrong response. I said, is there anybody in this house that's glad he died for the sins of the world? I'm going to ask it again. Is there anybody in here glad he died for the sins of the world? Here's the second question. Anybody glad he died, but he didn't stay dead? God raised him from the dead. I'm looking for the church folk. Because the good news is, if God got him up, there's nothing he can't get me up from. So you ought to shout for your salvation. At the beginning of a holy week, you ought to just thank God that he died for you, that God raised him, that God has given you a place in the kingdom. Y'all ain't shouting. I said, if you're happy and you know it, and you're saved and you know it, the old church used to say, show some sign that you're just glad. Come on, touch two or three people. Tell them, I'm just glad I'm saved. I'm just glad I'm saved. I ain't got a lot of money, but I'm glad. Hallelujah. Yes, sir. Sit down if you can. Just glad I'm saved. This new materialistic world we live in, sometimes you just ought to shout, I'm glad I'm saved. That'll help you get through your broke days. That'll help you get through your unemployed days. That'll even help you get through your sick days. I'm just glad I'm saved. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Yeah, just glad I'm saved. Just glad I'm saved. Just glad I'm saved. I'm just glad I'm saved. When you have churches in this modern day, and it's been very public, there are churches that are saying, because we want to be more seeker-friendly for Easter, we're not going to use words like the blood of Jesus, resurrection,
No, it's been in the news, crucifixion. And actually, church said, we're not going to use those words for Easter because we don't want to offend anybody. I want to let somebody know what is offensive is that you can have Easter and not mention the blood of Jesus. What's offensive is that you can have Easter and not talk about crucifixion. Because if it wasn't for the blood of Jesus, there would be no Easter. If it wasn't for the cross of Jesus, there. And the other reality is I can't get sinners saved without telling them he shed his blood so that you could have salvation. Anybody thankful for the blood, the cross, the resurrection, and you are determined those are words that will never leave your vocabulary. This is the most exciting week for the church, for the Christian church, because it begins the week that made possible the birth of the church, and that is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so we look forward to a glorious week. We've got some things planned over the weekend. On Saturday, we are doing our first Body and Soul of the Year. And I'm really excited about it, and it's really poignant, and I'll get to that point in a minute. But we're kind of redoing the longest table that the city does sometime. We're doing the longest table for the unhoused. We're going to feed them on Saturday, and we're going to give away, yeah, isn't that good news? We're going to give away backpacks. And what else are we giving away? Ponchos, wet wipes. Now, we're good on backpacks, but beloved, if you could help us this week, you can bring them to the church. We need some wet wipes. No, we got backpacks, so we need wet wipes. Oh, thank you, production room. If y'all could help me this week, we need some ponchos, some wet wipes, some travel hygiene kits. And now every category of ministry, we've kind of given you a section. Walking ministries, backpacks. Worshiping ministry, ponchos. Witnessing ministries, wet wipes. And working in wellness ministries, travel and hygiene. So now if you don't know which pillar you're in, that's okay. Just go get something. Because I know some of y'all are like, I don't even know what that is. That's okay. That's okay. Just go pick up some of this stuff and bring it to the church this week because we wanted to. Ministry to the unhoused has become more serious in this last week. The governor of this state signed, I don't know if you saw it because he did it under a cloak of darkness in the middle of the night. That's what cowards do. They do stuff when folk can't respond. He signed into law a bill that permits the homeless from sleeping in public spaces. I'm not making anything up. The comment that I heard him say was, we want to make sure that we are doing safety for law-abiding citizens so the unhoused are not law-abiding citizens. They are discarded as second class. But that's what happens when you live an entitled life. You don't know how to be sensitive to those who are not as entitled. And I'm just going to tell you right now, we got some regular tenants that live around this church, and I'm daring the governor and anybody else to step on our property and tell us that we cannot minister to the homeless and let them sleep overnight. As a matter of fact, we might just make a night where we come up here and hang out with them to send a message to the governor that what you won't control is the church. Huh? Does that sound like a good idea? And we will send message. It is sad. It is sick. It is satanic. If you want to get them off the streets, build somewhere for them to live. Come on now, don't get uncomfortable with me now. Lord, I wish he wouldn't talk. If you're a prophet, you're supposed to talk. If you want them off the streets, build somewhere for them to live. Give funding to agencies that can make sure they get back on their feet. Put money into agencies that can help them get a job instead of walking around here like a bigot and an ignorant person who discards the homeless. Why don't you do something, Mr. Governor, to put resources into agencies so that other agencies like the church can help people get back on their feet? Because the last time I checked, the homeless aren't serial murderers. The homeless aren't robbing banks. The homeless aren't bringing guns into our community. The homeless aren't selling drugs on the streets. The homeless aren't committing espionage. So quit calling them citizens who are unlawful. You're unlawful for calling them that. It's sad. It's sad. And so the church now has to take responsibility. And maybe we should thank the governor, because maybe what he has done is going to force the church to do what we're supposed to do. Because the Bible said Jesus told the folk that he was telling, depart from me. When I was sick, you didn't come see me. When I was in jail, you didn't visit me. When I was hungry, you didn't feed me. So maybe this becomes an opportunity for the church to exercise what we are supposed to do. So thank you, Governor, for giving. I don't take anything back I said, but thank you, because you've given us an opportunity to be the church. Amen. So here's what I'm asking. I'm flipping the script. My whole staff is about to go crazy. I'm asking everybody to show up Saturday to make a church statement about our belief concerning the unhoused. Now you might not be able to do some of the volunteering because we got a training. But even if you can't be here to greet, be here to welcome, I'm asking everybody to show up. Let's make a statement to the governor that you will not dictate how we treat the unhoused. Is that all right? Everybody, y'all show up Saturday. What time, Pastor, are we supposed to be here? 11. Y'all get here at 10. That means y'all will be here by 11. Let's just everybody show up Saturday. Everybody. We're not calling the news. No, we ain't doing none of that stuff. We're doing that not for publicity. We're doing it because it's ministry. So I'm asking everybody, la-di-da-di, even people who are watching on stream, show up. Even if you don't go to Bethel, but you're watching before you go to your church on Sunday, just come be with us Saturday morning. Because the body of Christ has got to make a statement about what we will not allow to happen when it comes to the unhoused. Amen. My name is Rudolph McKissick, and I approve this message. Secondly, before I move to Easter, listen, on behalf of Pastor and myself, let me just thank you all, reiterate again, for what was the most amazing anniversary we have ever had. Let me just celebrate. Let us celebrate you all. It was just an amazing, amazing day, amazing month, really. And you all just showered love on us in just unprecedented ways. People don't have to be nice, you know? And when they are, you ought to show gratitude for the niceness that people show you. And so we just want you all to know how blessed we were by last Sunday, by the love, whether it was finance, whether it was just a card, whether it was a card, whether it was a gift, because many people gave us gifts. No matter what your expression was, they were all equal in value. And we want you all to know how much we love and appreciate you. Now, if you didn't get a chance to give to the man of God last Sunday, there is a line in the giving that says Bishop's Love Offering, just in case you didn't get a chance to give last Sunday. The Bible is very, the Apostle Paul said, we don't read this a lot, in the book of Romans, I believe it was, it may have been Galatians, where he apologized to the church for not giving them an opportunity to sow into his life. And he said to that church that my not giving you an opportunity to sow into my life cut off blessings you receive when you honor the one that leads you. There are blessings that come when you operate in honor. And so if you didn't get a chance, yeah, it ain't no shame. At this point, I'm out here on the plank. I might as well walk it. If you didn't get a chance to give last Sunday, you can put it on your envelope, put my name on there. You can go to any of our giving platforms. You'll see Bishop's Love Offering on there. You can go to my Cash App, RUMCKJR. If the Lord leads you, you can do that. But we wanted to thank you all. Next Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. And I am so excited about Resurrection Sunday. I'm looking forward. Sunrise is 6 a.m. And the Father of the house has recovered. God has restored his strength. And he is going to preach sunrise. Can we just honor the Father of the house real quick? Show some love to him this morning. Come on, let's honor him this morning. Yeah. And we can't honor him without honoring our mother. Come on, let's celebrate. Even in her absence, let's celebrate our mother of the house. And so next Sunday, I believe we're going to have the biggest sunrise crowd we've ever seen. We ought to be here in number. Bishop has not preached in quite a while. The devil thought he had him, but he got away. And ain't nobody mad but the devil, and he wasn't coming to church anyway. So we ought to be here next Sunday morning at 6 a.m. for sunrise worship. I believe it's going to be he's going to give the devil a black eye next Sunday. I just feel it in my spirit. It's going to be an absolutely amazing 6 a.m. worship. Then our regular morning worship at 9:30. Now listen, sweet children, I'm telling you now, you won't be here 9:30 as well. Even if you come sunrise, go get you some breakfast and come back. Cause next Sunday, just be here. Just be here. No, seriously. It's going to be absolutely amazing. And I want to make sure that everybody gets this. I'm telling you right now, if you thought Mephibosheth was something amazing, look at your neighbor and tell him, child, you ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen nothing yet. It's going to be absolutely amazing. So that's our schedule for next week. There's some things going on as well, community-wise, that I want us to be aware of. We are hosting an event on March the 28th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. It's being sponsored by the Jacksonville branch of the NAACP. And the greatest fraternity on the planet Earth, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, Theta Phi chapter right here in Jacksonville, Florida. There it is right there. It's a very important conversation. We're not necessarily partnering with Omega Psi Phi or NAACP, but we are hosting. It's called For Culture and For Community, as you see on the board. And we've got some of our community leaders that will be here in conversation. Senator Tracy Davis, Representative Angie Nixon, ooh, this is going to be good, Supervisor of Elections Jerry Holland, and Monet Holder, who is the Senior Director of Advocacy and Programs at Florida Rising. It's going to be a very important conversation concerning our community, what we need to do in our community, voting, and everything. And so it's not a Bethel event, but Bethel is hosting. So I want you to invite all of your friends, and let's come Let's get answers to questions. Let's make sure they understand our passion. And let's give Angie and Tracy a message to take back to Tallahassee about what needs to happen in these African-American streets. And so I want to encourage all of you to be here. That's April the 28th at 6 p.m. It's scheduled for 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And I want to make sure that you are here. Just a couple of quick things, and then we're going to move on to offering, and I'm going to preach. I want to shout out Elder Adams and Kingdom Care last Saturday for the amazing job they did at the Weldon housing apartments, and for all of you who volunteered. Where's Elder Adams? I know he prayed. There he is, Elder. Hi. Do you have an estimate of like how many persons or families we fed that day? 150 families we were able to be a blessing to. Y'all can do better than that. Yeah, that's our evangelism ministry. And they did such a wonderful job. And then this past Friday night, Pastor Barry and Oasis had their movie night. Man, that gym looked like it was packed. And I want to thank Mincy and his organization, Mincy Pollock, for sponsoring that. They were here. They had popcorn and the like. And so I want to shout out Pastor Barry for the wonderful job that they are doing, and for all of our families. Yeah. Yes, indeed. And so we thank God for all of that. Now, those of you who did call the church office about the NAN Luncheon National Action Network, I'm being honored at the end of that week. We have filled up. I think we've got one spot left at the table. So if you desire to go, you that one, you better call the church office tomorrow. Nine of the slots. It is free. You don't have to pay for the luncheon. And so I want to thank those nine persons who have agreed to come and join Pastor and I there in New York at the National Action Network luncheon that Friday. Well, I will be honored. The church is doing a lot, aren't we? Yeah. I want to recognize we've got some very special persons with us on today, and I thank God for them. The Community Foundation of Northeast Florida and Brother Isaiah Oliver, who is chair and lead. I want them to stand for me. He's got some of his board here. Where's Isaiah and the board? Where are? Yeah, there's Isaiah. I know. I spoke to Isaiah on the way in. Isaiah, somebody we need to get to know. You've been in the city now about how long? Yeah, I knew it hadn't been a year. And so we want to welcome him and thank God for the Community Foundation of Northeast Florida and all the work that they are putting their hands to do, and his board. And so we thank God for his presence on today. Listen, we are Bethel. Repeat after me our core values. We love deeply. We worship passionately. We give biblically. We grow intentionally, and we serve willingly. Come on, let's say it again. These are the values of our church. Let's say it together. We love deeply. We worship passionately. We give biblically. We grow intentionally, and we serve willingly. I want you to get all of those. These are the values that represent who we are as a church. They describe the character of the culture of our church. We love. That means if that's a core value of our church, you can't let somebody come and sit next to you and you so deep in meditation that you don't speak to them. If we love deeply, you can't tell an usher, now they can't sit down saving that seat. If we love deeply, that means you speak to people, not just in the sanctuary, but speak to them when you see them on the street. I can't deal with Christians who speak in tongues but can't speak in English. We love deeply. We worship passionately. That doesn't mean everybody runs and jumps and hollers and screams. That doesn't mean that. Sometimes that's not even worship. Worship passionately means that we give God our best when we exalt him. In whatever way you might do it, We give biblically. Y'all know what that means. I'm coming back to that in a minute. We grow intentionally. That means you ought to be in a ministry. If you are not in a ministry, you ought to be in a ministry. We're going to be looking at, as this year goes on, doing some small groups so we can have discipleship and be a growing people. Then we serve willingly. That means you don't show up looking like you're mad to be here. You put a smile on your face. Those are our core values, and we thank God for those. We give biblically, and it is. It's giving time in the house of the Lord. I want to give a shout out to one of the sweetest ladies I've known all of my life, and that is Sister Jonestine Dago, one of our deacons emeritus, looking pretty right here on that pew. I've known her all of my life, and thank God for her. Every year around this time, she gives a memorial in honor of her family, going all the way back even to her parents and even beyond that. This is a family that has an amazing legacy in this church, with Deacon James Anders and Nettie Ruth Staley Anders, and then the Wheatons and all these names I've known since I was a little boy. The Staleys. Deacon Carl Young was the smoothest dresser I've ever seen in my life as a little boy. And the Dagos and Sister Tukes and her son, Brother Allen, all have gone on to be with the Lord. And she is giving this morning towards the History and Archives and Best Academy $500 in memory of all of her sweet family. And so we want her to know we love her and thank God. She does this every year to pour into the church. We ought to be thankful for people who don't just give a tithe and an offering, but even in special moments, they want to sow into the place that have sown into them. And as I said, this is a family that predates me, goes all the way back to boyhood with even our bishop. And so I want to salute her and thank God for her. Can we just celebrate her for sowing into the life of our church in this manner and thank God for her? Everybody ought to follow suit. You ought to give biblically and liberally and willingly. As you have heard this morning, we are doing a lot. We have a lot going on, and we have a lot that we have to get done. The maintenance of this church. It takes more than shouts to put an AV system in. It takes more than shouts to fix a historic steeple that was built in the early 1900s. And it takes more than shouts to absolutely serve and sow into those who are staff. People say all the time, and you hear it all the time, especially on social media, people talk about why preachers always talk about money. Because it takes money to do business. It takes money to live. But more, see, now y'all got quiet. Y'all, what if you had no money to pay the bills in your house? But more than that, and even more importantly than that, we give because it is in the Word of God that God has commanded us to do so. That ought to be the only reason we need. God has made a promise that when we give willingly, biblically, liberally, obediently, He never promised to give you money. Don't listen to that. He promised to give you blessings. That might be money, but that might be other things. A door open, a door shut, an opportunity. God provides all of those kinds of things when we are obedient. And how many of you can testify this morning that when you give God's way, God begins to blow your mind with blessings? So we're going to prepare to give. You already know our giving platforms. They're on the screen. If you're home this morning or you're traveling and you're watching, or you're on spring break vacation and you're watching, all of our giving platforms are on the screen this morning. If you are the old-fashioned giver, our ushers will be coming to receive your tithes and offerings. If you're ready to give, I want you to shout like you're ready to give this morning. Wait, hold on. Stop all that music. Stop that. That was, wait a minute, Lord. Wait a minute. Isn't that what Cat Williams said? Wait a minute. Wait a minute. If you are excited and ready to give, let me hear you give God a shout this morning. Yeah. And so God received the worship of our stewardship, the worship of our giving. We know that your church needs resource because your word declared that we give it so that there's meat in your house. Bless the giver this morning because we operate in obedience. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give unto the Lord.
Mm-hmm. but these heavy burdens, these old heavy burdens, they got a little too strong. Right now,
If that's your testimony this morning, can you just stand up and shout about it? You tried over and over, but you discovered there is no other way. Hallelujah. There is no other way. Matter of fact, I don't need another way, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you, choir, for blessing us. Come on, give God a praise that he is the only way you need. Hallelujah. Listen, before we get into the word, just two things. To all of our leaders, don't forget our ministry leaders. Tomorrow night at 6 p.m., we are gathering a very, 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 very important meeting. You've received a couple of emails about it. There will be dinner provided at 6 p.m. I promise we won't be long, but it will be strong. I need every ministry leader. Don't send somebody unless you just absolutely can't be here. But I'm really asking every ministry leader, as was shared in the emails you got, to meet us here tomorrow night at 6 p.m. We've had several families in this church that have had death in their family. Elder Sharon Bell in the death, very sudden and unexpected death of her sister. And that funeral is actually going to be here at the church, I believe, on Wednesday. So let's lift up Elder Sharon in prayer at 11 a.m. on Wednesday. Pray for the Jalukes. Deacon Ferdinand is still recovering from heart surgery, but his sister, pray for him in the death of his sister. One of the faithful sisters, she came, moved here, and just dove in and got really involved. Leisha Archie, pray for her son, Gavin, her parents. And her funeral will actually be here at the church on the 6th at 11 a.m. And so pray for her. For JJ and Mignon Hammond in the death of her mother, pray for them. And then for Brother Robinson Williams, many of us know him as Knee-High, and his sister Novella in the death of their sister. You'd have to be old school Bethel to remember Sister Rosemary Williams. Rosemary was in the choir for years. And so lift up that family in prayer as well. And so we've had several families that we need to be praying the prayer of comfort and grief about. Amen? Come on, let's pray. God, we thank you now, and we lift up all of these families. We know you are the God of comfort. You put your loving arms around us, and so every family that I've mentioned, and God, I'm sure there are some that I didn't mention, maybe I didn't know, but you know one and all. And so heal and comfort. Now stand up in me and grant unto me preaching power, that I may preach the unsearchable riches of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. And while you're standing, go to the 19th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. While you're going there, I read a statistic this week, and I was telling Pastor we went away for a week on a little rest. A statistic, Zella, that shocked me. The Barner Institute, who is the number one company that does Christian surveys, listen to this, did a survey of the unchurched. And it was discovered that 88% of the people that they surveyed that are unchurched said that they would come to church if invited by family and friends. 88%. The survey also said only 2% of church people invite the unchurched. Hear that again. 88% said if they were invited, they would go. But only 2% of those that go invite those that don't. I want to acknowledge and I want to challenge each of us in this room today to make it your business on Easter Sunday, to make it your business to make sure that you invite somebody to be with
us on next Sunday, whatever service it might be, but to be with us on next Sunday to share. Don't be in the 98% that never invite people to church to introduce them to Jesus Christ. How sad is that? 88% said they would come, but only 2% of the church invites them to come. I want to challenge you next Sunday to invite at least 10, because that means maybe 5 will come, at least 10 people that you know need Jesus in their life. Let's don't make Easter about dressing up. Let's make Easter about saving souls. So take up that challenge for next week. Luke chapter 19, verse 41. As he, Jesus, approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes." Amen. You may be seated. Listen, I also want to thank Anicia. Said, is Anicia here? Oh, there she's sitting up there with her husband in the booth. That's so cute. Anicia designed this. Did you do outside too? Yeah. Anicia designed this wonderful set. And it's still here. It's got, y'all know why it's got purple and gold. I don't have to explain that to you. The blue, I did find out though, the blue is for the Cowboys. Y'all are a bunch of haters. Bunch of haters. Purple and gold is for Omega and for Lakers. And the blue is for the Cowboys. And I want to shout out Anicia for such a wonderful job in putting all this together. Jesus said, if you, even you, had known what makes for your peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. On this Palm Sunday, I want to preach with this thought in our minds. If only you knew. If you are any kind of R&B fan, then the title of this sermon should resonate with you. It was made famous by Patti LaBelle, then remixed by SWV. It's a sad song about requited love. It's a song about a woman who is madly in love with a man who has no idea how she feels. She longs to tell him, "I must have rehearsed my lines 1,000 times until I had them memorized. But when I get up the nerve to tell you, the words just never seem to come out right." And she, if only you knew how much I do love you. Oh, y'all know that. Let me stop. What a tragic thing to have someone in your life who has no idea how you really feel. What a tragic thing to live with the despondent disposition because people have no idea what your real feelings are. And it happens right in this familiar story, this story. I know we treat this Sunday with great festivity and celebration. Back in the old day, Bishop and I were talking back in his office. I remember as a little boy, Deacon Bryant, most of y'all, 99% of you all in here don't know that name. He was a florist, worked at Kuhn Florist. And every Palm Sunday, he would ring our bell when we lived in the parsonage and have palms for us to wear. My mom and daddy made me put a palm on that was bigger than the suit I had on. And everybody would come with their palms. And we treat this Sunday with great festivity and celebration. But underneath all of that And in the context of that Palm Sunday day, there is a melancholy mood that should sober each of us. It was, to give you the history, this particular Sunday that became coined by the Christian church as Palm Sunday was the beginning of Holy Week. It was the start of the Passover, which was the most sacred of Jewish festivals, and Jerusalem was always in a stir. Devout Jews from everywhere had converged upon this holy city to commemorate God's historic liberation of Israel from Egyptian enslavement. It was a celebration of Passover. God had told each family, go and kill the lamb, and after you kill the lamb, spread the blood of the lamb over the doorpost of your house. I'm sending the death angel through Egypt. But when the death angel comes to your house, if the angel sees the blood of the lamb, that angel will pass over your house. Now, for a people now in the current context of this text, they are now under a new struggle, a new oppression. For a people struggling under the yoke of yet another oppressive power, namely the Roman Empire, Passover not only served as a painful reminder that they had been delivered, but it also now served as a painful reminder that they were no longer free again. And year after year, the Jewish people came together to recall the time God won their freedom in Egypt. But I submit to y'all today, there is so much we miss about this day we call Palm Sunday. For instance, there were two parades that went on that day. You've got to be a history reader to know this, because this isn't in the Bible. That while Jesus was coming in from the west to Jerusalem, Pontius Pilate, or as it is pronounced properly, Pontius Pilate, he was Italian. Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor of Judea, was coming in from the east in his own parade. The people lined the streets, the Roman citizens and Jews lined the streets to shout about Pontius Pilate, the governor of Judea. And coming down the other side into Jerusalem was the King of Kings, the Savior of the world. And these two parades were about to collide in the center of the city. It was a panoply of imperial Roman power with horses and chariots and foot soldiers and weapons and banners and a golden eagle mounted on the top of a pole. And Pilate knew that the mere sight of all that Roman power would be enough to deter any thought of Jews rebelling against the Roman Empire. On the other side where Jesus was parading in, Matthew tells us that the people spread their coats on the ground for Jesus to travel over. This was customary for a new king. Are y'all listening? John is the only one that mentions palm branches. Touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor he's about to mess up all our palms. Palm branches were a politically loaded symbol that reminded the people of something from their history that's not recorded in the Bible. Y'all ready? 200 years before Jesus makes this entry, the Seleucid Empire ruled over Jerusalem. They had a king by the name of Antiochus IV Epiphanes. He destroyed Jerusalem. He desecrated the temple. He slaughtered an unclean pig and spread the blood of the pig on the altar in the temple before destroying the temple. He then ordered all of the people, all of the Jews, to offer sacrifices to all of his many little g gods. And in this one town, they all refused. There was an old priest there by the name of Mattathias. Are y'all listening to me? We're going to shout before it's over. There was a priest by the name of Mattathias. He killed the king's inspector because Antiochus Epiphanes sent inspectors into every city to make sure every Jew had destroyed every temple and were worshiping his gods. And Mattathias, in this one little city, killed the king's inspector, tore down the altar that had been erected for these gods, and then went on the run, and they couldn't find him. And history tells us on his dying bed, he had five sons, and he said to his five sons, whatever you do, avenge the wrong that has been done to your people. Pay back the Gentiles or the Romans in full. And his words inspired his third son by the name of Judas. Judas became a force of vengeance. He did so much vengeance against Rome that he was given the nickname the Hammer, which is called Maccabeus. How many of y'all ever studied history and discovered Judas Maccabeus? Judas Maccabeus. Maccabeus was not his last name. Maccabeus was the nickname he was given, because Maccabeus is called the Hammer. Y'all listening? It is what they know in history as the Maccabean Revolt. And as he made Judas, as Judas made his entry into Jerusalem, I'm going to mess everything up. As Judas made his entry into Jerusalem some 200 years before Jesus was born, because Judas had destroyed everything that Antiochus Epiphanes had put up from a pagan society. And as Judas made his way into Jerusalem, y'all know what the people did? Waved palm branches. Those palm branches became a key symbol of their quest for independence. Are y'all listening? Those palm branches ain't had nothing to do with Jesus. Those palm branches were political statements that they were glad Judas Maccabeus had destroyed the people trying to kill them. Now, some 200 years later in the life of Jesus, Rome is back in oppressive power. And these people see Jesus coming in power. And they are reminded that just like Judas gave us liberation, so can Jesus. So then, y'all know what they did. They went and got palm branches. As a symbol, I'm finna come get you, as a symbol that when they waved these palm branches at Jesus and laid their coats on the ground for Jesus and started yelling, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Hosanna means save now. Can I tell you what they were really saying? They took the palm branches to remind themselves of what Judas had done 200 years later, earlier rather, for their family. And when they waved those palm branches and shouted Hosanna, what they were really saying is, Lord, do it again. That's what they were really saying. When they waved those palm branches and shouted Hosanna, they were saying, what you did before, yes sir, do it again. How you delivered us before, do it again. How you made a way for us before, do it again. How you fought our battles, do it again. How you destroyed our enemies, do it again. How you made a way out of no way, do it again. And is there anybody in here today, you may not have a palm branch in your hand, but you can wave your hand and say, God, like you delivered me before, do it again. Like you made a way before, do it again. Like you opened doors before, do it again. Like you healed my body, do it again. Like you made a way for my family. Somebody ought to open your mouth and just yell, do it again. Come on, I need somebody in here who knows if the Lord did it before. Come on, touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor, if he did it before, he will do it again. So the next time you come to a Palm Sunday, oh yes, you need to remember that they were saying, Lord, if you use Judas, you can use Jesus. Do it again. Anybody need the Lord to do something for you again? Anybody need the Lord to make a way for you again? Anybody need the Lord to open some doors for you again? Anybody need the Lord to heal you again? Anybody need the Lord to see about your family again? Then throw your head back, put your hand up like you got a palm branch, and just yell, do it again. That's what they were saying. Do it again. But that is where things got dicey. A strange thing happened. No one saw it coming, and very few noticed it. Amid all of the excitement, nobody seemed to notice, Bishop, that there was one person who wasn't celebrating. In all of the excitement of that day, Tim, they didn't notice that there was one person who was not rejoicing. They didn't notice, Kim, that in all of the shouting they did that day, there was one person who wasn't smiling. He wasn't having a good time. In fact, the verses I read to you, Luke lets us know he wasn't shouting. He was crying. While the crowd shouted cheers, Jesus shed tears. And somehow, as improbable as it may seem, the crowd failed to notice Jesus's tears. That's why I let y'all get all that shout out. And Luke says that as Jesus cried, he uttered these words long before Patty, Taj, Lily, or Coco. He shed the tears and said, "If only you knew." Preach Rudolph, McKissick. He shed his tears. Read it again in Luke 19. And he said, as they were shouting, they were dancing. The glory button was pushed on the drum. They were dancing and shouting. The hammer was at an all-time loudness. And Jesus was crying. And Jesus said, if only you knew all the things that made for your peace. And now in modernity, in modern times, we come to this Sunday every year. We come together on this Sunday and we sing songs about Hosanna. We wave palm branches with gusto. It's a festive day. It's an energetic worship. And not once is the church troubled by the fact that our emotions in worship match the crowd's glee, but not the Savior's grief. Preach Rudolph McKissick. We come together and celebrate the crowd's cheers, but ignores the Savior's tears. The Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people, but could it be that sometimes our praises make him cry? I submit to you, don't worry, we'll shout for us over. I submit to you today that he's still crying. And he's crying with all that stuff y'all doing. If you only knew what really made for your peace. And I knew this was going to be heavy for a Palm Sunday. I knew I was going to mess up our Palm Sunday, Sunday school, Christian theology about those palms. But we need to know this, because while we no longer live in an oppressive Rome, we do live under an oppressive system. Don't get quiet on me now. Rome may not be on the throne, but we've got some politicians who are on a throne operating under oppressive systems of disenfranchisement. Y'all done got quiet on me now. Florida and Alabama and other states have now eliminated diversity, equity, and inclusion in the name of the church. Y'all done got awfully quiet. We still live in oppressive systems. We've got money to send in foreign lands for wars, but can never find money to make our streets look better and put programs into play. Y'all done got quiet on me. This system is neither Democrat or Republican. This is just an oppressive system. Y'all don't get quiet on me now. Why is it that Congress can vote on money to send over to foreign lands? Mr. President, what you should be doing is calling for a ceasefire, not calling for more money. And if y'all got millions to go to foreign lands, why can't we even get thousands to make our schools look better, our streets look better, policies and programs to help those who are the oppressed and the disenfranchised? It's still an oppressive system. Y'all gonna get quiet on me. It's okay. There is no national peace. We're killing each other on the streets. Robbing each other. Y'all are awfully quiet on me now. Y'all didn't expect this on Palm Sunday, because what the preacher doesn't teach us is that Palm Sunday was a political statement, not a spiritual statement. And don't wave your palms if you won't fight for peace. For many people, they don't have personal peace. There are many people who find their peace in the bottle, or find their peace in the pills, or find their peace in the weed, or find their peace in the sex, or find their peace. Y'all are awfully quiet on me in here. There are people who cannot find personal peace. And yet we come to church every Sunday, shout and run and dance and holler and scream and wave. And the Lord is looking down on us with tears, saying, if only you knew how to get your peace. I got three things to say to you, and I'm going to be out your hair, because right now I feel the tension in the room. Y'all are just like, I thought we were going to shout Hosanna this morning. There are three things I want to suggest. One, that they understood but misunderstood how to get. Here's the first one. You know why they were shouting Hosanna, even though they missed how it was going to happen? I'm going to come back to that. You know why they were shouting do it again? Here's the first point. If you're going to fight for your peace, if we're going to fight as a people and as a community for our peace as a nation, and if you're going to fight for your personal peace, you've got to first declare, I am meant for more than this. Come on, you ought to say it with me. I am meant for more than this. Here is what I noticed in what Jesus said. It was what Jesus didn't say. His tears, read what I read to you again. His tears were about them being ignorant of what was going to make for their peace. His tears were not because they wanted peace. Hear me again. His tears weren't because they wanted peace. His tears were was because they were ignorant of what was going to make for their peace. Remember, they are under political and financial and spiritual oppression at the hands not only of the Roman government, but at the hands of Jewish leadership who was doing the bidding of the government. But here was the deal. They lined those streets shouting Hosanna because they knew who they were and remembered who they used to be. Y'all ain't hearing me. They knew they were God's elect. They knew they were God's chosen people. And at this point, their lives weren't matching their identity. Y'all better hear me. They know who they are. And because they know who they are, they know that what they are putting up with is something beneath their value. Y'all better hear me. You only want peace and will fight for your peace when you know that oppression isn't normal. That's all right. I came to deliver somebody, even if nobody shouts. You got to stop believing that oppression is normal if you're going to find peace. It is not normal to wake up every morning mad. Y'all ain't happy. I'll be back in 5 minutes. It is not normal to need a drink every night to go to sleep. Y'all ain't happy either. I'll be back in a minute. It is not normal to have people talk to you like a dog and you walk away talking about that's just who they are. When you reach the point of saying, I know who I am and I am not built to deal with this, you will fight for your peace. Come on, look at somebody and tell them, you don't have to put up with that. No, no, you don't have to put up with that. So they are shouting Hosanna because they know who they are, but see where they are, and they are shouting for a rightful return to their place of identity. And Hosanna was their way of saying, we are done putting up with this. Every movement of our community, every movement within our culture has had Hosanna moments. Martin King, in what they call the dream speech, it wasn't a dream speech because that wasn't even in the speech. That was a Hosanna moment. Rosa Parks, when she refused to give up her seat on that bus, that was a Hosanna moment. Y'all are getting quiet on me in here now. But now, in the modern day, our Hosanna isn't with palm branches. It should be in voting booths. Preach, Rudolph McKissick. Woo! Y'all ain't talking to me in here today. The Hosanna of the modern day ain't palm branches. It's voting booths. Because when you go in that voting booth, you say, I'm done dealing with this. I'm done having the city council like this. I'm done with a mayor like this. God knows I'm done with a governor like this. Our Hosanna is in the voting booth. On your job, sometimes you got to have a Hosanna moment. Like, I know you my boss, but now you ain't going to talk to me like I'm beneath you. I know you my supervisor, but you're not going to talk to me like I'm some dog. Y'all done got quiet. Sometimes you got to have a Hosanna moment and say, I'm going to respect your position, but you're going to respect me as a person. Sometimes in your life, you got to have a Hosanna moment. Now, you ain't going to cuss at me and think it's just going to end like that. No. Am I preaching? It's because you know who you are and know that you are meant for more than what you are putting up with. One of my favorite books that I read in seminary, I would encourage everybody, and I would even encourage you to get your children this book. It's by a gentleman by the name of Viktor Frankl, V-I-K-T-O-R-F-R-A-N-K-L. He wrote one of the greatest books. Pastor's father is the one that introduced me to it. It is entitled Man's Search for Freedom. In the revised is Man's Search for Significance, man being generic, meaning humanity. Frankl was a Nazi prisoner who was beaten every day of his life. He was beaten. He was urinated on. He was spit on. And he wrote in the book this quote, Bishop, everything can be taken from a person, this is going to be good, except their freedom to choose their attitude in the face of any given circumstance. Come on, I know I'm going real deep this morning. Let me read Viktor Frankl again. Nazi, in a Nazi concentration camp, he was a Jew, beaten, whipped, spit on, urinated on, called out of his name. And the story goes that Frankl had a smile every day. Linwood, he prayed every day. He spoke blessings over the folks spitting on him every day. And so Frankl wrote in the book to explain why he could do that. He said, because everything can be taken from you. Everything can be taken from you except your freedom to choose your attitude. The one thing you can't take from me is my freedom to respond how I choose to respond, no matter what you do. Y'all done got quiet on me. Because freedom is not the absence of restraints. Freedom is the choice to choose my attitude in my circumstance, not giving the restraints restraining power. Preach, Rudolph McKissick. When I know who I am, you can't strip from me my attitude. You can call me everything you can think of, and I'll smile my way right through it. Because you waiting to see me break. You waiting to see me cry. You waiting to see me quit. But I choose my attitude. You can't make me mad. I choose my attitude. You can't make me feel worthless. I choose my attitude. You can't make me feel like I'm lower than a duck's footprint. I choose my attitude. Now, I'm almost done. If attitudes lead to actions, then that means you can't even take from me how I'm going to act. So when you see me smiling and you know what I'm going through, I'm not being phony, I'm making a choice. When I still speak to you and ask you how your family's doing and tell you I'm praying for you, and you know that I know that you know that I know that you've been talking about me like a dog behind my back, I ain't being phony with you, I'm making a choice. Because I know I'm meant for more than this. And you can't take the one choice I still have. Which means I'm going to wake up every morning with bills I can't pay, 15 pill bottles I got to take, with friends who have forsaken me. But because I get the right to choose my attitude, I'm going to wake up saying, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Come on, touch somebody and tell them, I choose my attitude. They were yelling Hosanna because they knew they were meant for more than this. Number two. Oh, this is gone. Yes. Number two, if you're going to get your peace, you're going to get your peace. And here's why Jesus was crying. Don't get locked into what I call the sin of sameness. Don't worry, I'm making it make sense. Jesus cries, and hear his words again. If you only knew the things that make for your peace. They don't know the things that will make for peace because, are y'all listening? They are operating under the assumption that what will bring them peace is the same thing that brought them peace in the past. A king who will take them to war and take back their peace. Remember, they got palm branches because it reminds them of what Judas Maccabeus, the hammer, did. Killed everybody and got their peace back. They remember through oral tradition that every time God wanted to get rid of contaminating nations that had the threat to contaminate the nation of Israel, God would send them to war to kill. And they got them palm branches because they are living under the assumption the same way God did it before. He's going to do it the same way again. They are not shouting praise on Jesus because they think he is going to a cross to win peace. Come back next Sunday. We're going to shout and all of that. They're not shouting Hosanna. That's what we do. Because we on the other side of the cross. But for them, they wasn't shouting Hosanna with palm branches. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They wasn't doing all of that because they thought he was going to a cross. There was nothing spiritual about what they did. Put them palms down. Y'all taking to church every Sunday. That is not a spiritual statement. Ooh, it's quiet now. Somebody's sneaking, trying to take theirs off right now. Like, let me get rid of this part. No. It was all national and political. They are shouting because they are expecting Jesus to pick up a weapon, get an army, and lead them into battle as in times past and get their peace back. They missed the memo. God is going to do it again, but God is not going to do it the way God did it the last time. Oh, it's awfully quiet now. Hear me today. I'll give y'all one quick shout in about 10 minutes. God is not tied to sameness. And Jesus entered Jerusalem the way he did, trying to show them that he was not the hammer of God, he's the Lamb of God. Preach, boy. This time it would be different. Hear me? If you don't hear anything else I said today, if you try to lock God into sameness, you might miss your miracle. Because I'm a living witness. God can bring provision from unexpected different places. Water from a rock. Next time, water into wine. Y'all ain't talking to me. Banquet from a lunch. Y'all ain't talking to me. Next time, fish from the ocean. Y'all ain't talking to me. Fire from a bush. Savior from a virgin. Are y'all hearing me in here today? So instead of trying to find your solitude and your peace, that God's going to do it like he did it the last time, find your comfort in God's diversity in his ability. That instead of expecting God to have a routine, make your expectation, any way you do it, God, I'm going to be satisfied. Am I talking to anybody in here? The reason some of us can't get with God is because we always looking for God to do it the way God used to do it. But God told me to tell somebody today, get ready for new strategy. Get ready for new doors. Get ready for new connections. Get ready for new opportunities. My boy has had it right. Any way you bless me, I will be satisfied. I'm done. I knew this was going to be rough this morning. I'm done. Tried to say two things to you so far. You're going to fight for your peace. You've got to determine I am meant for more than this. And I'm going to have a Hosanna moment that lets you know I'm not putting up with stuff. Number two, I'm not going to tie God to sameness. I'm not going to get upset when you don't do it the same way you did it the last time. The last time I paid the bill, this time I'm going to cancel the bill. Somebody should have ran right there. The last time I canceled the bill, this time I'm going to give you unexpected money to pay the bill. The last time you had to have surgery, this time I'm going to heal it supernaturally. Anyway, I feel my Holy Ghost coming. Any way you bless me, I will be satisfied. Somebody throw your head back and just yell, any way you do it, God, any way you do it, any way you do it, I'll praise you, I'll wait for it, I'll hold on to it, any way you bless me. All right. Here's the last thing. Here comes the shout and the good news. He sheds these tears. He says, if only you knew that all that shouting y'all doing, y'all got the wrong attitude about me. He sheds these tears like, what are y'all doing? But here's the shout. His disappointment doesn't derail his determination. Okay. I'm going to help you shout. Read what Jesus said as he prayed. If only you knew the things that make for your peace. Read what he says. But now it is hidden from your eyes. Verse 43. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and your children within walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. Now they doing all this shouting. And Jesus saying, y'all don't even recognize God. They doing all this dancing. Scholars say that here Jesus is predicting the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple around 63 AD. He is prophesying, John, and predicting that the Romans are going to tear down the temple and the city. Here's what's deep. Jesus knows that Israel is not going to receive him as they should. He said it. He knows they are going to reject him. Just like Isaiah predicted, he was despised and rejected of men. He knew, oh, this is about to be so good to me, that they were not going to receive him because by Friday they would vote to kill him. He knew. In fact, the reason for his hesitancy in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said, let this bitter cup pass, it wasn't because he was scared. He just knew at that moment in his flesh, in humanity, it wasn't going to work out. He knew, I'm coming for you. He knew they wouldn't receive him. He knew they wouldn't submit to him. He knew they wouldn't worship him. That's why he's crying. He knew they would turn their backs. He knew the very ones that were shouting by Friday they were going to vote to kill him. But in spite of all of that, he went to the cross anyway. I'm trying to help somebody in here. He was determined to die even though he was disappointed. Now, I don't know about you. That makes me shout. And do you know why that makes me shout? Because I disappoint him on a daily basis. I disappoint him with the way I talk. I disappoint him with the way I treat people. I disappoint him with the choices I make. But how many of y'all are glad today that he never loses his determination to make ways for me even when I disappoint him? Y'all ain't happy. As a matter of fact, you will run out of sin before Jesus runs out of love. Y'all ain't talking to me. Y'all ain't happy in here today. You will run out of sins before God runs out of grace and mercy. High five your neighbor. Only time I'm going to tell you. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, you ain't got enough sin to make God run out of grace. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn on the other side. I done got happy now. Look your neighbor in the face and tell them, neighbor, there aren't enough sins you can commit that will make God's mercy run out, that will make God's love run out. And if there's anything we can shout on Palm Sunday, it's that in spite of his disappointment, he died anyway. In spite of knowing they would turn on him, he died anyway. Sometimes that ought to be your greatest praise. He did it anyway. Sometimes your greatest shout ought not be thank you for the house, thank you for the car, thank you for the money. But sometimes your greatest shout ought to be, God, I thank you that in spite of me, you did it anyway. I'm done. You better get your own shout. Go on and high five somebody and tell them he did it anyway. I can't explain it, but I'm happy he did it. That was the wrong neighbor. I'm sorry, y'all. I done got happy because I can't talk for you, but I know for myself, I disappoint him a lot. But every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he keeps on making a way for me. I got to get out of here. Good morning, sweet children. May the Lord God bless you real good. But is there anybody in here who can stand on your feet if you're glad about it, that he did it anyway? High five your neighbor. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn all the way around and look your neighbor. Look him in the face and say, neighbor,
I can shout now, because every morning I get new mercies. Every morning I get new grace. Every morning I get new love. And now I have to give him glory, because I made him cry, but he died anyway. I made him cry, but he loved me anyway. I disappointed him, but he loved me anyway. If I were in the old church, I would say, amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that brought my liberty. This new church don't know hymns. He would go on and say, I don't know how he came to love me so, but he looked beyond my faults and saw every one of my needs. Y'all ain't happy. I'll see y'all next Sunday morning. But I got one cry in the old church. Bishop, on first Sunday night, we would say, will the Lord remember me when I am called to go? Somebody ought to throw your head back and say, remember me. I know I messed up, but remember me. I know I didn't do right, but remember me. I know I didn't treat my neighbor right, but remember me. I know I didn't treat my family right, but remember me. And I'm glad he remembered me, because one Friday, oh no, I done got happy, y'all, on a hill called Calvary, they hung him high, they stretched him wide, he hung his head in the locks of his shoulder. He died, didn't he die? He died all night Friday, he died all day Sunday, but early Sunday morning, he got up with power in his hand. High five your neighbor and say, neighbor, he got up with power in it. I done got happy. There's power in the blood of the Lamb. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is that flow that makes me pure as snow. I feel my Uncle Bob in here. Is there anybody here who knows my Jesus? Is there anybody here who knows my Lord? Do you know it? Have you tried it? Ain't he all right? He's like a wheel in the middle of a wheel. He's like fire shut up in my boat. I tried him, and I know he will make a way. He will turn your life. He will give you another chance. He will restore your joy. He will renew your mind. He will dry your tears. He will fix your heart. And one day, when it's all over, he's coming back to take his church. So now, unto him who is able to keep me from falling and present me before
the church. Say amen. Yeah.
They made him cry, but he died anyway. They disappointed him, but he died anyway. And every day your praise ought to be, thank you that you died anyway. You don't have enough sin that can outrun his love. Enough to make you treat people right. That ought to be enough to make you love people. There's one thing the body of Christ is missing, is love. We are so toxic in our insecurities that the way we run each other down, even in public, it's toxic. The way we treat humanity. It's toxic. What ought to be enough to make you love everybody in spite of skin, nationality, religious preference, sexual preference. I ain't talking about now sin. I'm talking about love. What ought to make you love everybody is that the Lord loves you. You made him cry. I made him cry. And he died anyway. Now, how you gonna treat people like they dirt? How? How you gonna run your mouth about people and tear them down? Say all manner of evil against them. When Jesus loved you anyway, some of us need to heal from the toxicity of insecurity and the anger over how life is treating us. And we're taking it out on other people instead of facing ourselves. Even if they are everything you say about them, what does that have to do with you treating them right? What does that have to do with you taking their name out your mouth? When I know that the Lord died for me anyway, how am I gonna treat you that way? This nation lacks love. We don't lack politics. Politics is dirty. We lack love. Politicians aren't called to love us. They don't. Democrat or Republican. This country lacks the love for humanity. That's what we lack. We can't even love each other in the church. And we expect the world to want to come to us. But when I recognize that I made him cry, Jesus, have mercy. I made him cry. Did you hear what I just said? I made him cry. And he still died for me anyway. Just for me. Lord, have mercy. Just for me. Came and did it just for me. That ought to be your testimony every day. Just for me. Just for me. Is that your testimony? Jesus came and did it just for me. Lord, have mercy. Just for me. Me. Just for me. Me. For me. Can you sing that one time? That's the whole thing right there. Just for me. Just for me. Just for me. Just for me. Lord have mercy. Just for me. Jesus came and did it. Jesus came and did it. Just for me. You ought to just lift your hands and say, just for me, just for me. Yes, sir. Me, just for me, just for me. Me. Yeah. Oh, Jesus came and did it. Can you just say that one line? Yeah, oh, Jesus. I get that in your spirit this morning. This ain't talk to your neighbor, no. This is just say it. Oh, Jesus came. Listen to me this morning, all over this sanctuary. Lord, have mercy. He did it just for you. The good news of the church is that he doesn't have to die again to receive you. He died once and for all. And all you have to do is receive the gift.
all you got to do. He died for you. Hear the depth of that. He cried knowing they would never receive him. And yet he died anyway. Don't let his death be in vain when it comes to your life. He died for you. Jesus doesn't care what you did, who you did it with, how long you've been doing it. Even if you did it this morning, he still died for you. Because there aren't enough sins to outlast his love. Isn't that good news? So this morning, you're in here, Bishop. I've always heard that Jesus died, but I've never accepted it because I'm an analytical and I don't believe all that stuff. That's why it takes faith. I'm to the point, I never argue with agnostics or atheists. I'm not gonna argue. Because this God thing is about faith. And unless you're gonna operate in faith, you and I will just argue forever. It's a faith thing. You will not intellectually figure it out. You just got to have faith enough to believe that he died for you. And that he reserved a place in heaven for you. And that while you live on earth, you can live in the midst of blessings in spite of the burdens that come with life. Bishop, I've never accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I've come to church. I know who he is. I've heard about him, but I've never accepted him. You're in here this morning. I want everybody, if you're able, to just stand on your feet all over the sanctuary, if you're able, if you're physically able. Bishop, I've never accepted him. I've just, you know, I thought because I came to church every Sunday that I was fine. No, there's not a scripture verse in the Bible that says if you come to church, you'll be saved. That's not in the Bible. The word of the Lord says if you confess with your mouth on the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. If you don't know for certain that if you die today, heaven is your destination, I'm talking to you. Second category, Bishop, I am saved. I don't have a church that unpacks that Bible like you did this morning and it helps me see me in that Bible. And I want to be in a church where the Word of God is taught. And you're in here this morning. Final category, Bishop, I got baptized maybe at a young age and I strayed away and I got out here and I was doing life my way. But like the choir said this morning, I'm discovering there is no other way to live without Jesus. And so I want to rededicate my life, reconnect my life. Or you're saying, now, Bishop, I don't understand all of that, but I know this. I need Jesus in my life. I can't keep living my life like I'm doing. If you're in any of those categories I mentioned, I'm going to ask you to do something. This is not to embarrass you. I'm not going to put a mic in your hand. I'm not going to ask you your name. None of that. But if you're in any of those categories this morning, I want you to grab your personal belongings right now and meet me at this altar right now. You're in the balcony. I want you to come to those stairs or the middle stairs and come through the doors. You're on the main floor. Pick up your belongings. Make your way to this altar right now. You don't have tomorrow. All you have is right now. Tomorrow is not promised to you. All you have is right now. Hey, bless you, baby. Bless you. Hey, I see you coming over here. Come on. I see you coming. I see you coming. Come on. Come on right now. Come on right now. Right now. Right now. Grab your personal belongings and make your way right now. Wherever you are, make your way, make your determination. Bless you all. Bless you all right now. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Come on, I feel like there are more of you in here. I want to make a choice today. I want to make a choice today. I'm changing the direction of my life. I'm making a commitment this morning. I'm connecting to the Lord this morning. Do me a favor. Would you ask your neighbor on your right and your left, even if you know them, ask them, have you confessed Jesus Christ as your Savior? Ask them. No, ask them for real. You can't be scared to ask people that. Have you confessed Jesus? If they say yes, move to the second question. Ask them, are you committed and connected in a church where you are growing? That's the important. Where you are growing. If they don't say yes to both questions, grab them and say, child, let me walk down with you. I can't let you leave here today without making the best decision of your life. And you walk down here with them right now to the greatest choice of their life. Don't let anybody stand next to you and didn't give a yes to both questions. Listen, if you're online this morning, you're saying, Bishop, I want to be a part of your church, but I don't live in Jacksonville, or I'm not close enough. You can be a digital disciple of this church. And all you have to do is do what you see on the screen. Text TBC Decision to 54244. That's all you've got to do. Text TBC Decision to 54244. A text will come back to you. Click the link in the text. Fill out all of the information and send it back. And our team will be in touch with you. To those of you at this altar, what a grand and glorious choice you've made today. What an awesome choice you've made. That's your son? Yeah. All right. Oh, you my man. Come on up, because you got a Laker jacket on. I'm going to receive you myself in Jesus' name. You got to dap me up, though. That's the Laker. What size is this? It's my size. Yeah. All right. So you like that purple and gold up there, then? All right. I need you to have a little more enthusiasm next time I do that. No, I'm just playing with you. We welcome you this morning. Our team is going to take you. They've got their AIM shirts on. They're going to take you and get your information, tell you what your next steps are. Adonica, go ahead and take them. Come on, can we celebrate them as they move right now? Can we thank God for each and every one of them? Listen, we're getting ready to go down from this place. Do not forget, every ministry leader, 6 p.m. tomorrow night, I need you in the place. Do not forget body and soul. I want everybody to be, I want us to make a statement, because the unhoused have become the new weaponized focus of this governor. And the church needs to stand up and make a statement. And so I want everybody to be here Saturday. Let's make a statement. And I'm serious, we're going to plan a night. I don't know when we're going to do it, but we're going to plan a night. We're going to make a statement. What you're not going to do is think you're going to govern what we do when it comes to the unhoused. That's that. We're going to make that statement. Then don't forget, next Sunday, 6 a.m., sunrise with the bishop. And then 9:30, it's going to be a glorious day. Invite 10 people to meet you in this place. Father, we thank you that even though our hosannas were misdirected, you loved us so much that you died anyway. Help us to fight for our peace. We want to fight for our peace. We want to fight to be who you called us to be. Bless us as we leave the place, but never your presence. Keep us, guard us, guide us, and protect us is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Grace, grace.